friends, to begin tonight's very special evening, it's my pleasure to call upon Karen Seidman, representing the Montreal Holocaust Center, for some words of introduction.
Hi, good evening. I'm Karen Seidman, and on behalf of the Montreal Holocaust Memorial Center, we're very proud and very happy to be partners on this event, bringing the story of survival, bringing a great message from one generation to the other generations. I won't speak so much because you didn't come to hear this wonderful story, and so I'll leave it up there.
And it's an honor for the MDC to partner with the Montreal Holocaust Memorial Center for an event like this, which is all about remembering and remembering for the purpose, as Karen mentioned, of passing the torch to the next generation. And I'm just coming now, as we speak moments ago, from addressing the children of the March of the Living. And the privilege this year to be the rabbi, to lead the Montreal contingent. And we just had a very, hopefully, a really meaningful encounter. And I told the children, there's two ways to go to Poland, an outsider or an insider. It's somebody else's story, or it's my story. It's my story indeed, because all of us friends, all Jews, we're one, we share the same heart. Tonight, we're going to hear a very special story, and we're going to introduce those who require no introduction, I'm sure, but nonetheless. And to follow protocol, of course, you may not know his face, because you just know his voice, but that's one of the most famous Montrealers, Mr. Tommy Schnuramcher, who graciously agreed to teach us. We're very grateful indeed that Tommy acquiesced to host, interview the author of the book and the protagonist of the book. The author of the book, start with the author, my sister-in-law, in case you didn't know. Did you know that? Not everybody. Okay. My wife's sister, Shane Rosenthal, Tuky Treitel. And of course, she wrote a story of her mother. You know her name, don't you? What is it? Yeah, you remember. There you go. It is indeed Tuky, and it's the story of Tuky. And without further ado, my dear friends, Tommy, Tuky, and Sherry.
The entire book from cover to cover. And I didn't particularly relish the idea, to tell the truth, of reading children's book, because I haven't read one since Dick and Jane, which is a long, long time ago. And I started reading the book, and from beginning to end, it was absolutely, absolutely riveting. It starts off as talking about a six-year-old girl in Hungary, and the details of the story of what it is like to be a six-year-old child in Budapest at that time were so real, it brought back incredible memories of tastes and smells of life at that time, because I was also at 1.6 years old, a child in a Jewish home in Budapest. So that was all very, very familiar. As I continued to read, that was very interesting. Then the story had a plot line that kept me wanting to turn to the next page and to the next page and to know more about the characters. And on top of that, it also has a very important message, very powerful message that really resonates today and every day for everyone. So it was a pleasure to read the book from beginning to end. It's very interesting, and it presents a beautiful story, but a very difficult story, but a story written in a way that makes it appealing and understandable and comprehensible for young children. Young children will be fine with this book. There's nothing that will upset them about it, but they'll get a very powerful message. So I'd like to start with interviewing the author and Tuky herself, and I'd like to start with you, Shannon. When did you first hear the story of what your mother went through?
I only remember because it was just part of our childhood. We always knew that my mother had this incredible story. We always knew, and we still know, that my mother is still incredible. And she just was able to finagle and just do all these cool things. And I know we've always knew. We just always knew. I know for now I can tell you that my mother always asks my grandchildren, my sister's grandchildren, my brother's grandchildren, how old were you now, Goldie? When I was your age, you know? So it must have, we must have been very young. It was part of us.
Let me ask you this, Tuky. When, it's your story, when did you make the decision, do I talk about it, am I going to tell my children about it or not tell my children about it?
I don't think it was a decision. I have to say something. First, I always feel like apologizing because thank God I'm here. I'm not here. This way? Okay. I always feel like almost like apologizing. Because I'm here to tell the story, and unfortunately a lot of them didn't. But I had one message, and that's, I think this is the purpose of the whole thing, the message, the power of one. Hitler was one and made the whole world crazy, and everyone participated, they were thrilled, because he decided the Jews have to be gotten rid of. And he did a very fine job of it. And my message is the power of one. And I survived, and at the end I will show you what I have to show. And part of this building maybe also, part of it, some of it. So now going on to the story. I did not make a decision. It was just, first of all, we came here very soon after the war. And everything was so fresh in our minds. And I remember when my parents rented an apartment, looking, where will I get out of here? And people were wondering, what's this question? Because it was always with us.
You wanted to know where the exits were.
Exits, sure. Right? The first thing we came in, this is where we come in, and let's see if we have to run, where do we go? I was looking for the way out. It wasn't a decision, it was just there. And when my children were growing up, I was telling them that it wasn't always like this. Also because I wanted them to know, and also I want to make sure to know that they should know how fortunate they are. And to live not long ago, when it was July 1st, how fortunate they are. My grandson just sent me a note, Happy Canada Day. And I sent back a whole big thing. To me, it is very happy. We live here, we brought up children here. I can be Jewish, you can be from, you can do whatever you want. You walk around the shekel and the yarmulke, and you eat kosher. And my children went to the same yeshiva from nursery till they left. I went to the sixth grade about eight different schools, different cities, different countries, different language, different everything. So I was very important for me that children should know.
When you had your first child was about 6 years old. Is that when you wanted to say, when you looked at your first child, said, what a different life your child had at six, and you had at six?
Maybe I consider myself very fortunate, and I like to pass that on to my children as well. And I did make a point whenever I had the opportunity to say, you're having it good, it's fine, but no but, it's good.
Oh, there's no but?
No but.
All right, let me ask you this, Stanley. What was it like? You wrote the book, it was very well written. To do the book, you have to interview your mom. What was it like interviewing your mother?
It was a great experience. Actually, I did it. My father was still alive, and we spent a lot of time going over the memories. Obviously, they didn't grow up together, but certain memories they have, which were the same, the yellow star, they were going to tell me exactly the color, the shape, the way it felt, how big it was. We spent a lot of time talking, and it was really a beautiful thing, very, a lot of bonding, and actually a byproduct of it is that I did the adjustment found, but I also called to interview my father and get his story in chronological order. So that was something we were happy about.
And you spent a lot of time on it.
Yeah. You said you spent a lot of time on it, and Shemi just mentioned the yellow star. When we're specifically talking about that, wearing the yellow star, what was going through your mind? What was going through your head at the time?
I was thinking, no matter what I will say, it is, you can't transmit it. You can say it's a story, but you cannot imagine walking around. Why do I have to have this? I can't say. Why do I? And whenever I could, I sort of covered it or didn't cover it. But those days, walking on the street, a Jewish child, anybody, including a 15-year-old kid, could beat up anyone. Could beat up a lady on the street because just because she's Jewish. So you were so labeled, you were like, stand, go ahead, do whatever you want.
And was it difficult to talk about it with your children?
No. I didn't find it difficult. I thought it was very important that they know. That's the only reason why I accepted this, because I feel it's very important that people know that, you know what we had and how good we have it and appreciate it.
When you think back on your childhood, tell me what you remember about your father.
That's my parents, like everyone's parents, especially when they're not here anymore, they're really, but my parents were legends in their time. Our home was open, no matter how many people, just people arrived, no invitation, no anything. There was very, very rarely that we woke up in the same place where we went to sleep because she told us that other people were sleeping there. And my mother never set the table for less than 20 people. There was always someone coming in to eat. Always on the parents were also very religious, and everything had to be just so. There was no such a thing as cheating or doing a little bit less. This is the way it is. And my mother's word was always, Shemis Borach will help. Don't worry. And she really, not like today, a lot of people, they say, they do good things. There was no such a thing as it's a mitzvah, that's the only word we heard, that it's a chesed, or to do a favor. This is it, they breathed it, they lived it. Like my kids would say, You grew up in a, you breathe holy air. That's what my girls say. You breathe holy air. They didn't know anything that this is the way it has to be. If you can do for somebody anything, anytime, there. People strolled in and they stayed. They stayed. Sick people, my mother bathed babies and nursed people into them. This is how they lived.
Did you speak Hungarian in the house?
Only till this very day.
Getting back to your parents and your father and your mother, when you said you had a lot of guests coming to the house, as you recall, as a child feeling, well, maybe some of the guests are getting some of the attention and you're not, as a child.
No, that's for sure, because our duty also to entertain them and snickering and making fun of them.
Oh, as a child, that also happens. Now,
of course.
What do you recall of, what was the name of the street? Koloshvan. What do you recall of your Jewish neighbors?
Jewish neighbors were not so many. Before the war, we had some people, some actually relatives. My aunt lived on the other corner, and across the street was an apartment building, and mostly held. But Jewish neighbors lived not so close to us. They were. We always had a minion Friday night. Our house was a very busy.
And the non-Jewish neighbors?
Non-Jewish.
Because you started meeting the non-Jewish neighbors when things got worse in Hungary, right?
We met them all the time. We met them all the time. One was helping the house, and they were, it depends, it depends. On a good day, we could be very friendly, we could even play with the kids sometimes, but if they could, they...
There's always some suspicion.
Always, always, we're always, we knew we were different, we were always different.
And when, later on in the book, I mean, the book starts painting a beautiful picture of how wonderful that is in your home, and everything is perfect, and your handstands, and everyone is very happy.
And
things
get fun.
A little worse and a little worse thanks to the Hungarians making the alliance with the Nazis. What do you recall the first time your father said you have to stay with someone else?
That was okay. The first, when they took us, when they hauled us away, then my father wasn't there. I mean, actually, he saw the truck pulling up in front of the house, and he had just come home from school, and he was standing on the corner, and he saw what's happening. They're holding us in, and my mother with a baby in her hand, and being pregnant. And he said he had to make a split-second decision. Do I join them? Then I lost. If I don't go, I can still help. Because he had the means to, and which he did. He bribed the people. He bribed. So, he made the decision not to go. So then they put us on a truck and they called my mother into a detention center, which is sort of like a jail. And in the afternoon they brought like family services where they took the children away. That's the only time I remember crying. I don't think I cried through the whole thing, but that 2 days I think I cried every day.
So tell me, who was there? You?
I was in this certain home where everybody was in the detention center. And they divided us. They didn't take 8 children into one house.
They arrested
my mother and they kept and 8
children.
Only from the detention center. They all went together to the detention center. Then they came in and they divided, they took kids to different places. Me, they put, and they put me to a very pleasant, very nice place. It was just very strange and I didn't know the people. I think it was two sisters or two friends, I don't know. I don't
know. We're not Jewish.
With me, this, I don't even know that. I don't know how, I don't think that. I think maybe they might have been.
And how long did you stay with these people?
Not too long.
Why?
2 days. I don't know if my father, I don't know if he found out, or maybe this was just a way where they placed us and then they placed us somewhere else. Then they took me to another place, and from one home to another, not Jewish people.
And at this point, did you know where your parents were?
No. No.
How did that feel?
Terrible. I mean, how do you, but you know, after the first day, I realized that this is what it is. And it's very interesting how resilient children are, because...
You were six.
This was in the fall, my birthday was in August, August 8th, and this was in the fall, and I wasn't very old. Actually, I started grade one. I started grade one, that's when I found out that this is not, and the teacher said, you can't come back tomorrow, nobody's coming back tomorrow, school is closed. So I went home, and school was closed. I didn't have a chance to really dislike school, so I wasn't staying there. I'm so happy. I didn't know I was supposed to be happy. And then this is what happened. So they took us from one place to another. Then one day my father said that you'll have to go to a village and you're going to stay there until we come and get you. I don't remember the exact word, but what I remember of which I will never forget. When he blessed me, he blessed me and he said, remember, you're a Jewish girl. So, and don't forget your name and you're a Jewish girl. Because there was a risk, unfortunately, which happened to many, many children, and nobody knows, until this day they don't know they're Jewish. They were left by people and the parents weren't alive and they didn't come back to pick them up. So whenever I think of this story, that's what I think of. How many are out there? So that's what I was thinking then. And then with my father, we had the coins. The Belzerebe was in Budapest, and my father saw what was happening, and he said to the Rebbe, he took a bowl of coins. He said, bless these coins, I want to see my family. And everyone had a silver coin, he made pierced holes on them, and hung it in our necks. And every single member of family had it, and whoever had it came back, and not one coin remained. That's really, you know, so we think sometimes it's, you know, belief in tzaddikim and God help us. Like my mother said, Shabbos Boran helps.
Sherry, as you were doing the interview, was any part of the interview the information you received from your mother and father, was any of it difficult for you to deal with as a child?
Well, we knew most, I knew most of the information, not necessarily in chronological order, but I will say that I would interview my mother, write everything down, go home, sit at my computer, write it, rewrite it, come back the next day and say, Mom, and I'd read it, and I would say that quite a few times when I did read it, even though these are stories which I had known since I was this little, I would read it to my mother, and we both cry. We're really not criers. We don't, you know, I don't feel bad for this, we read and we cry. It's just, those are the stories I think we knew. Maybe the details not.
I wanted to say, I remember my hair being wet from my father's tears.
Yeah.
Tell me about what it was like with the families that you were staying with, what they were, non-Jewish families on the farm, what it was like, what your daily life was like on the farm.
My daily life was, well, when I arrived, they showed me I slept. Those days, it's not an unusual thing, it's not because I was a Rachmanis, it was very common in Hungary and the villages that the mattress was a sack filled with straw. So that's what we slept on, with two other girls. So I was waiting for them to fall asleep, and then I said Shema, because I knew that you can't go to sleep if you don't say Shema. So that's the way it was. In the morning we got dressed, and we played with the girls, just like everybody else, the kids. Of course, cursing the Jews, and I said, sure, of course. All this problem, everything is because, everything bad that happened was because of the Jews. And lunchtime, was a drummer came to, there was no radio, no news, otherwise I also didn't have a radio, but there was no paper, so lunchtime a drummer arrived to the village on a bicycle, threw down his bicycle, and everybody went out to listen to the news. Of course, cursing the Jews all the way there, all the way back. So I used to run fast, that they shouldn't hear, that I should be out of breath so I could say a brocha, of course, on pork. But I said a brocha nevertheless. I knew that I can't eat if I don't say a brocha. So that's a blessing before you eat. So that's the way it was. And on the way back, I went back and I finished my pork.
Tell me the story, the part of the book that talks about this Hungarian soldier who's getting Jewish children together to herd them onto a truck and how he saved you.
That was
a big
okay. After, well, we failed in the country, okay? It's in the book, we failed in the country, they found out that we're Jewish children. I was on one farm, and my brother, who's nowhere here, and my cousin, they were on another farm, right nearby. So, and every day I checked on them and I tried to say my dad and whatever was whatever I knew at that age. And there was, on the next farm, there was a calf was born, a new calf. And they were fascinated, my brother and my cousin, they loved it. They went back every day to check up on the calf. And it's so cute. And we love it. Then they decided they want to buy the calf. They tell the farmer, we want to buy this calf. Said, okay. You know, the farmer, they're teasing, they're just like everybody today with kids. Of course, you can buy the food. Fine. Okay, when can we have it? The calf has to nurse for 2 weeks, you have to wait 2 weeks. When the calf is strong enough, then you can have the calf. They're counting the days, every day they went back to see the calf, what the calf can do, and now it's suddenly nuts. It was fun. They go back, on the 2 weeks are up. 2 weeks are up, we want the calf. Of course, I don't have to tell you, we needed a calf in Budapest, like you need now a horn. They wanted the calf. And so the farmer says, you can have the calf, but you have to pay for it, and you have no money. My cousin says, we have no money. When the Russians beat the Germans, kids knew politics like you can't imagine, little one. When the Russians beat the Germans, we get back our factory, we can buy all of Tsimokas. And what was the custom, which is still the custom in Europe, then in Russia they say, they sit outside the intelligentsia, the chauffeur and the police and the gendarme and the lawyer or whatever, the doctor, then in the tent. But they were all there and they looked at each other, what can they buy? Where can they buy? And they right away knew it was Jewish children. I did not know about it because I went back to the place where I was staying. And in the evening, knocked on the door and they came to get me. Taking me to the police station, which they said police station, but today I know better because there was a billiard table there. And they said, there stands like two little acquaintances, my brother and my cousin. Wiping their noses and saying, and they asked me, what's your name? And I pulled myself up, my name is Lodich Maria. That was my name, Lodich Maria. In Hungary, first you say the family name and then the first name. That was the name I was given when I was sent to the farm. So he says, what's your name? Say the truth. I says, Lodich Maria. Then he shows points to the billiard table and takes up one of the billiard sticks. If you don't tell us your real name, we're going to beat you with this stick till you say your name. Till you bleed and you say your name. That's all my little cousin had to hear. She said, her name is Marianna Gestetner and her mother's name is Gisela Salomon. That's the mother's name. And that was that. Then they hauled us up. Then they were walking, and this is a miracle. They took us, they go to get rid of these Jewish kids. A gendarme was going on a bicycle. Chender, you know what Chender is? This is Komlor. Okay? That was going on a bicycle, and we were walking next to them, but the person where I stayed, he came with a thermos of food. Yes, he did. He came with us till the first, arrived the first little town, and they said, the ghetto, we have the kids here, we want to put them in the ghetto. Our town is clean of Jews. They were very proud. No ghetto, the last transport went yesterday. This is how we went to three small towns. The last one town we left, we missed the ghetto by hours. The transport,
the transport was taking people to
the Yes, the last one. Then they sent us back to Budapest, which was on the train. And we got to Budapest, and they put us into another big detention center. It wasn't even a ghetto, it was definitely a detention center. So the first day when I was in, then we had, thank you. First day I was in, they put me into a room where there were only women. And one lady, this week, I think, I remember, I don't know how old, shrieking, there are still children alive, I want my child, but shrieking, she lost it completely. She wanted her child, she saw me, so they put me out of that, because she really, really, she couldn't stop, she was shrieking at the top of her lungs, lost completely. She said, the children, she wants her child. So they put me somewhere else, then they put me into a basement where they were keeping only people that were shipped off to Germany, to Auschwitz or Birkenau, wherever it was going. So that's where I stayed, I don't know how long. And then I saw on the window, it was a basement, there was bars, and I saw my brother's shoes and my cousin's. So I called them and they came over, and I used to tie their shoes and say my dummy with them or whatever. Whatever broke, I remember. Then came the time that they opened the door and they were shipping. A truck pulls up to the door, and an SS stands there with a pad and thinking of all the names. And it came to my turn. I just went up to him, stood in front of him. I remember. I think I could go back to rehearse it completely, repeated. I stood in front of him, stood myself up, and I said, I'm sorry, I cannot leave from here. I have two little brothers that cannot tie their shoelaces. My mother is sick in a hospital. My father is a soldier. I made it up on the spot, and I can't leave from here. He hit me. He said, he picked my name off, and he pushed me behind the door. The door stayed there. When the truck pulled away, then he said to me, scram, get lost. And so he actually saved me because, you know, he had a promise. He had just had pity on me. I don't know, maybe I was.
You were cute.
I was.
Do you think my mother was cute?
After that incident, if there's a part of the book where you regularly go up and ask if there's a package,
yes.
Tell me about that.
When I was out of here, when he told me to scram, I got into another ladies' bunk. Every day I went to the office and I asked them. I told them my name is Mariana Castella. In the book it says Malka because that. My name is Marianne Gestetner, and I want to know if I have a package. Do I have a letter the next day? They were making fun of me. I insisted that I want to go every day. I went to check if I have a letter. And lo and behold, I think this is how my father found me. You know, he had the means to bribe an SS, and then they took us out.
What was left out of me?
What
didn't you put into the book?
Sterling,
that's a good thing. Just not to do, just a small part of it.
What was your
mother
like? Killing
Well, being that it was written for children, and it's geared for ages 8 to 13, however, children younger who can read will read it. We wanted to be true to the story without giving children nightmares. It is an introduction to the Holocaust. It is not the only piece of Holocaust literature which someone should read. So therefore we were very careful not to include too many of the gory details. Death, killing, die are there. As well as there are some other great family stories which didn't make it into the book because we kept it only about my mother, as well as the story really ends in the ghetto. However, they were there for 2 weeks, 2 or 3 weeks in the ghetto before they were liberated. And incidentally, my grandmother gave birth on the day of liberation in the ghetto. But we didn't put that in because, and it's actually that I was really upset about because my editor said, a book can only have one ending. You can't have two endings to the book. So we emailed back and forth for about a week, and then I said, okay, whatever, okay, it's not in. But the story went a little farther, and...
Oh, yes.
My mother has a very vivid memory, and this I knew as a child, and I don't know why we weren't scared of it, maybe because we always knew that my parents will always protect us. This wouldn't happen to us. But my mother says when they were going from the, when they were walking to the ghetto, because my mother was reunited with her family in the Swedish safe house. If any of you know, Raoul Wallenberg had allowed people with connections to go to this house. My mother was only there for about 2 days, and then they were herded to the ghetto, and they were walking in a straight line, and the line stopped, I guess, you know, like traffic, the one in front stops. So a woman in front of my mother, she was wearing a camel coat with a red and white kerchief, and when the line stopped, she, you know, appeared to see what's happening, and she was shot on the spot. And my mother remembers it was springtime, and it's winter. She remembers her blood coming out and sizzling. This is a memory which I obviously wouldn't put into a book like this.
Yeah.
And mommy, you can tell them what your cousin said, your teenage cousin.
Cousin is not here anymore, and she said, walk straight, be proud, we're Jewish, don't walk with your heads down, just walk straight up.
Teenager.
You know, teenager then you went. Then once my mother's sister also said, she said, now I'm even more proud of it, I know you could do this. You know, they were shooting their bodies all over the place with placards on them. This is what all the Jews will look like, and this is what we're getting rid of them. So, you know, my aunt just said, she says, I'm so proud to be a Jew, because if this is just so cruel and so heartless, if we could never do this.
Yeah. Sherry mentioned that you didn't put a lot of the issues, or a lot of what you saw about death and dying and the killing into the book, but there was a lot of that you saw as a child, and as a six-year-old and so on. What do you recall of it?
I don't know. I remember my brother screaming, pick me up, I don't want to walk on them, pick me up. My mother was pregnant, didn't eat, I don't know for how long. My mother, by the way, only ate kosher, whatever she could, but she did not eat drink. Because Shami's Borak will help, and she will have a healthy baby, and she does. That baby is now a great-grandfather.
Sure.
We also didn't write that my mother stole and hid under a truck and watched as the driver was going into the truck, and she was afraid to move because she would rather stay under the truck than be caught
with my bread.
With her bread, which she hid under the skirt. We didn't write that, but
no. Protect.
Yeah, protecting our own name. Yes.
What was life like when you first came to Montreal? You and your family?
We've been to so many places. Belgium, in Germany, we were in 3-4 different cities. And I don't even remember being elated, or it took a long time till it sank in that we're not moving anywhere and we don't have to pack anywhere. My mother moved 11 times in 3 years with children. Nine children. And 11 times, packed up pots and pans and clothes and whatever, and moved. And they moved on it. They weren't moaning. They just did what they had to. And motto and slogan was Shemis Borat Helps. So, and I did.
How did she deal with being a widow?
My mother was an amazing woman. My father, just at the Shabbos table, didn't even fall off, like, at the age of 51, my brother 3 years old. And 1955, and he had established a factory here. And my mother, after the Shiva got up and went to the factory, I'm going to save this for my children. And she did. She worked alongside with Italian workers. This was very common, Italian workers. And she did, and she was very proud. And the following Shabbos, our house was full of guests. After the Shiva, the house was full of guests. Anybody lonely those days, there was a lot of people, men came back, either widowed or older boys that didn't have homes. They all congregated in our home. They lived, they came, they joked, they had fun, they ate, and they felt at home. Everybody. My mother got a vacuum cleaner every day. Another somebody borrowed it and took it for the day. She had a washing machine every day. Something, and we were dead at the house, in the house, okay? But she always had room in her heart, in her home, in her kitchen, in her bed, anytime, everybody. So that's the kind of a place I come from.
What are your recollections of Budapest?
You mean life in Budapest before? Don't smile, it wasn't that good. Before the war, my collection is very short and very limited, because I was rather young. And afterwards, also, the house was constantly full, and weddings weekly, and in the house, weddings, beating not the mixer was beating it, and not the cuisinier. They were grating by hand, mixing by hand, and the cakes were made by hand and hours, but there was always something happening. Also, we always had older girls, and they were married, and we had one wedding gown, everybody did the same thing. One bride came back, tears in her eyes, she was 4 months pregnant, and after the wedding. Okay. Yes, she got married in our house, and 5 months later she came back 4 months pregnant. That's right. I don't even have a wedding picture. My mother said, no problem, the gown is here, call a photographer. I was holding the gown in the back, there was all the buttons, and they took a picture, they were happy as anything. And she had a wedding picture. Nothing was a problem. Problems become when you create something.
Have you been that?
Yes.
What was that like?
I went touring. It's a beautiful city. I don't feel anything. Actually, I think that the biggest anti-Semite. The Hungarians cleaned up more people in 3 months than they could manage anywhere. Am I right?
Yeah.
Okay? So, no soft feelings there, I'm sorry. It's pretty, but it's not, nothing to do with
it. I want to get back to the main message that you had in the book, that comes through in the book about the power of one. Tell me about your power of one.
My power of one, I have a few samples here. For Hashem, I actually have a picture. This, some of my grandchildren, great-grandchildren, last place left, just a little bit on an outing, which standard around if anybody wants to see it. My power of one is that I came back and established a home, and we have Baruch Hashem children and grandchildren, and like I said, and they all grew up being from and Jewish and doing, I think, doing Hashem proud. I think so. Doing them proud. Because they're just, I think, good.
I want to thank you both. Before we get to the questions, it's very important, this picture. I recall a number of years ago, I was told by somebody that I really like Chabad. I'm very impressed with Lubavitch. I really like Chabad. I only have one problem with them. And I said, what's the problem? And she said, I think that the problem with Chabad is that they don't do enough about the Holocaust. So I want to say this is what they did about the Holocaust. Feel free to ask. Go ahead.
It's two-part. Can you scale, on a scale of 1 to 10, talking about fear and ask, if you can scale how fearful you were, what level of fear you lived with, and then if you can describe that fear in as many colors as you can, so I can...
The level of fear that you had. Okay, I'm just repeating in case somebody...
Question,
the question was on a level of 1 to 10, what was the level of fear that Tuky felt as a child, and how did she deal with that fear?
I can't measure, I don't know if you can measure fear. I really don't know how you can measure fear. But afraid, really afraid. What would you like, how would you describe fear?
Me?
Yes.
Really afraid sounds like a 9.
Maybe more like a 12. Right. You can tell that 15.
Right, you don't know, you know, if you're going to make it to the next day, you don't know where your parents are, you don't know anything.
You always look behind. Who's behind you, and what do they have in mind? When are they going to hit you? Where is it? What's next? And don't forget, I was also very young, really. So that's... and sometimes when you... And also the advantage of being young, when I was with my parents, it wasn't so scary anymore. Because you feel protected, you know, they're there. When I was alone with my siblings on the farm, it was different. Absolutely, not only that, but he paid a fortune for it. A fortune that did not take us, they jeopardized their lives. My parents were the only ones how much children that jeopardized. Actually, Rabbi Fegershaw told me this. That he was going in synagogues in Budapest and he had no papers. He was 16 years old at Yeshiva Bocher.
What year is this?
In 1944. He wasn't Hungarian, he came from Czechoslovakia, he came from Pressburg, and the yeshiva dissolved, and they said, all the boys have to leave. Where are we going? Don't go home, because that's occupied, everybody's in ghettos. Where do we go? Go to Budapest. Budapest was still fairly safe. He came to Budapest, he goes into a synagogue, and the first thing that come over to him, in German, Bucher, haben Sie Papieren, haben Sie Schriften? Do you have documents? No, he says, you have to leave. You're jeopardizing us. They find anybody here that doesn't have papers, they kill us all. So he goes to another shul, the same thing. You have papers? No. He said, well, you have to leave here. You can't stay here. Then he says, what am I going to do? I'm 16 years old. I don't know anybody. Go to the Gestapners. You don't know how many people stayed in us. My parents had no problem, you know, said maybe they're home. In my home, if there is room, they're not coming. And they had room in their hearts and they had room in their homes. So no, we did not have such a big house.
Yes.
A little
louder, please.
I will just bring you back my attitude. Unfortunately, my husband was very sick, and there was a psychiatrist that called to me because I'm in denial. And he asked me one day, I became best friend. I had a very good time. And with the psychiatrist, and he asked me one day, how do you do it? I said, Dr. LaRue, I have such a long thank God list. This is not so good. But tomorrow it can change, it can be better. You were like, now to people ask me, how are you? I said, I'm fine. I make up my mind, I want to be fine. You can decide. A lot of things in life is attitude. You know, we dwell on so many negative, unimportant things. That nothing to do with so Holocaust. Everyone has something nice and good in their lives. Cash in on that, build on it, enjoy it, and go on.
The question is to describe how it was when your father got all the children back. Yes? Is that the question?
We didn't all come back at the same time. I remember the first time I went in the Swedish neighborhood house, in the Swedish protected home, and I saw my dad's and I cried. I didn't cry right through, not by the Germans, not in the farm, and not in the detention center. When I saw my father, I cried. So, you know, like, that's when I let go.
How long were you separated
for? I wouldn't know. I don't know. Hindi will know. I don't know. Hindi will whisper it in my ear.
Yes?
I don't know. Some of them, because we were...
We didn't hear the question.
Are the non-Jewish people who held out, have they been recognized by Yad Vashem?
Definitely, yes.
You know what, some of them, till we were in Hungary, they came back in the summer, they spent time with us, and some of my cousins, they didn't know the mother anymore. So they had to come back and stay with the children till the children were familiar and they recognized and they would call again mama. Because they didn't know. Yeah, that's true. The ones that helped us, they were shot.
Children. The people who helped on the farms were all part. Which ones were shot?
The ones that found us, the sources. Those were, a couple, a wonderful couple. And they are recognized by Yad Vashem. And they found the farmers. They were the liaisons. And they had my father's money to pay them. I mean, my father couldn't walk around without that money.
Right.
And they kept it, they had the money. And my sister and my cousin, 11 years old, they were the messengers. They brought the money back to my father.
Friends, Hindi, please stand up. The older sister. The family story.
My father saved over 2,000 people during the Holocaust. He organized people, groups who helped me. I said a printer printed the false documents. Thousands of outfits for when you have to go into the military to the work groups were all treated for the cold. There were signs in synagogues all over Budapest that anybody who needs to be outfitted to go to the military can come to the Gesetner factories on the second floor and he'll be outfitted with everything he needs, rucksacks and boots and sweaters and jackets, anything. And but he gets there, Mr. Kessler must not be thanked for it because it's not his. He just gives the place for these outfits to be distributed. And people came and came and came by the thousands. And they were up to that. But this started in 1938. And it never ended.
Thank you. you so much. Tuky and the author will be mainly with you. Also, you'll be outside in the signing books in the lobby here to purchase a book. Excellent for Hanukkah gift giving, or poorer gift giving, as the case may be. And, oh, yes, let me do this one. Oh, yeah, look at this one. And you don't want to miss this. Believe me, you don't want to miss this. The therapist and the spiritualist, Dr. Lori Petito, the show you make here on CJAD called, if I can say it, Passion, and Rabbi Anis Friedman sharing their wisdom on how to achieve enduring intimacy. It's followed by a question and answer period. Wednesday, March 2nd, 7:30, right here at the Torah Center. Couple, and it's for couples and singles of marriageable age. $20 online, $25 in New York. You really don't want to miss this.
That's Jewish for mother.
Pictures has to be, you know.